Tonight, we're talking about how not to be fooled by a game and making sure you get what you expect in a box on episode 248 of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, Clickbait Games, how to avoid mismatched expectations when choosing games.
We start off answering a great question from one of our Patreon patrons and highlighting some red flags in regards to not getting what you expect from a game. We've got a couple of announcements to make and then share what we've been playing, including an interesting mix of new hotness and some old classics that got back to the table. Then we've got three reviews: Caution Signs, Shadow Ninjas, and the Hornhelm expansion for Cartographers.
But before we get to all that, some introductions. I'm Sean, your host, and here with me we have the Tabletop Bellhop, the ruler of reels, Deanna.
Hello to all the fellow cardboard connoisseurs out there.
And the Tabletop Bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the Tabletop Bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your game nights better.
This episode brought to you by our Patreon patrons and our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild. Show up Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop to watch us record this podcast live.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com/episode248. That's 248. Links may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing but support us.
And most games we will be talking about tonight were provided by publishers in the form of review copies.
The Tabletop Bellhop team is here to answer your gaming and game night questions. Tonight's question comes from one of our awesome Patreon patrons, Paxinarian, who writes, "What are some hints or indications that you'd advise people to look for to avoid mismatched expectations of games?"
It's a great question, Pax. I actually got to pick tonight's topic, and I picked it because I feel like it's something that keeps coming up in our conversations. We've had some of those mixed expectation games hitting our table lately. I think it's something Sean went off on a random rant on last episode. So it seemed like a topic that was top of the mind right now.
So I think this is actually an important and timely topic, as there has been a lot more of this going on in the industry as publishers try to fight for limited shelf space and limited eyeball time in an increasingly crowded market. With thousands of games coming out every year, the time a publisher gets for you to look at their game is getting vanishingly small. And unfortunately, some have chosen ways of using that time that could be considered misleading. Fantastic art, award nominee stickers, big box sizes, and extra player counts. All of these can easily be used to mislead the customer, and not always intentionally. I'm not trying to suggest that game publishers are doing this maliciously, but regardless of intent, sometimes the message gets confused. And you end up going home with a game that is vastly different than you expected.
Yeah, this one's rough because there are so many different things that can mislead you about a game, where it could be the advertising, it could be the box, it could be the backs of box blurb. It could be the Board Game Geek little from the publisher.
Yeah, I want to talk about Sherlock Solitaire, which I was playing recently. And I asked Wise Wizard Games for a review copy of that game, specifically after reading the blurb on it and thinking it was a solo solve the mystery game. Everything about it, if you read the box, says that you're going to play as Sherlock Holmes and you are going to solve a mystery. And it is more of a solitaire game in that Sherlock solitaire, like playing solitaire, laying cards down and making patterns. Okay. There is no mystery to be solved here. And it's actually a great game. I really enjoy it. And if they had just used a little bit of different wording on the box, like just thrown in something about set collection, anything like that, that wouldn't have been a jarring. Like that first play, take out the instruction booklet. It's beautiful. It fits in the box just perfect. The box is really nice. I'm so excited about this game. I open it up. I start reading the instruction booklet, and I'm like, what the heck? It was just that mixed expectation, right?
Yeah, and the other thing, too, to note that we don't necessarily mean these are all negative. We're not just talking about the game is worse or it's terrible or it's not what you expected at all. You want to return it or you feel like you're wasting your money. There's also the pleasant surprises. What we're talking about in here is the missed expectation, right? I buy the game expecting one thing, I get it home, and it's not that. And what we can do to limit that from happening, because I'm sorry to say, you can't trust the box art anymore. You can't necessarily trust the name of the game or even the designer. There's some really heavy game designers put out games and you're like, wait a minute, this is designed by that person? What was the one the other day Dee and I were talking and we figured out something was Martin Wallace? And I'm like, that's Martin Wallace? Like Martin Wallace Steam? Counts. Yeah,
Electric Counts.
Yep. Yeah, so Warhammer Fantasy Roleplay Electric Counts.
And then, I mean, there's some great games out there that are fantastic, but may mislead people. Games like Root, which have the cute and cuddly fun box art, where that is a heavy game. This is not the game that you want to bring home for your kids, despite the cute and cuddly animals on the cover.
What I want to point out first, before we get going too far, because that one fits here. We did an entire episode specifically on games like Root. Games that look like kids' games, that they're targeted at children, that aren't for kids at all. Like, there's some that are actually adult and look like they're targeted at children. So just to call it an old episode, this isn't so old ago that Deanna's going to tell you, don't go listen to it. But episode 207, and it was called Looks Like Kids Games, But They're Not, which is a pretty straightforward title. So go check that one out for kids games. And what I want to do from here, since we already kind of dove into it, is start talking about red flags and things to watch for. And Sean, I think, called out the first one, which is animal artwork does not mean kids game.
Yeah, this is something that it kind of bugs me to some degree. I mean, people have heard me rant on this sort of thing once in a while. I'm not a big fan of anthropomorphic characters, just use humans. But especially when you're looking for that serious, heavier game, when you're looking for something that you want people to take seriously, the big 4X meaty game with a 3.5 weight on BGG, or, you know, a coin game that's going to take all sorts of deductive reasoning. Why are you making this cute and cuddly? It just seems to me to not match the audience, the prime audience of that game. Sure, there may be people who like, you know, cute and cuddly creatures who also like heavy 4X games, but it's harder to take the game seriously when you've got that more sort of friendly and fantastical, la-di-da, cute artsy or artwork.
So I think Root is now popular enough that it's past that hump. People know it's not a kid's game. But it definitely, I think, would have suffered from that when it first came out.
The thing is, like, why are people doing it? Because it worked. Look at Root. Root set all kinds of records. It has won more awards than possibly any other game. It's ridiculously popular. So to be honest, I think the reason people do it is because it works. That these animals, the people who grew up watching Robin Hood and Gummy Bears and are now adult gamers are like, yeah, this is cool. Plus, and this is the main reason that Root does it, and I think this is a great reason to do it. Otherwise, you're playing a war game, and war games reflect reality, and you play forces that are based on real-life forces, some which did horrible things. So by putting animals on it, you no longer have to play the Nazis to play the game, which I think is way better than the alternative.
It's true, and I think it jars expectations to say, hey, this is like a heavier game, but it's got this cutesy look to it, and that gets some attention to it, maybe, whether that's good or bad.
So we're getting into the actual clickbait there. Maybe it's clickbait.
Yeah.
Like, I'm sure that's part of it, too, right? Like, I think Root got a whole generation group of gamers into counterinsurgency games that wouldn't have touched it otherwise. But yes, there is definitely can be a mixed expectation. And another example of something a little midweight was it Forges of Ravenshire?
That was going to be my next. That was literally the next one on the tip of my tongue. They're using that same sort of thing. You know, they've got the cute badgers on the front cover, but that is a, you know, it's a 2.5-3 weight game. It's an
economic,
so. Yeah.
It's a medium to heavyweight Euro economic game about playing blacksmiths. Now, the funny one about that is we met with the art director and designer of that. The artist was there, too. And how many meetings they had over how each animal should hold a hammer. And they decided they had to give the badgers thumbs. So it's not like these designers aren't thinking about it. Like, they're not. Yes, they're giving it a cute theme, but they're not just pasting on animals, which I think is kind of fascinating.
Yeah, that's true. I think for me. OK, so I'm going to go back to that example of Sherlock Solitaire. Mm-hmm. And I did my research beforehand. It's a newer game. There weren't really any reviews out there. I did a quick look around and I went, oh, I think this game is what I think it's going to be. Tir na n'Og, which we played lately. Mm-hmm. I love that game, but I have referred to it, and I mean lovingly, as Math the Game. It is all about patterns and math. And it is not actually about a magical journey to the fairy realm, which is it's very little. Like, you remove the theme from that game, the game remains completely the same. If you come into that game expecting an epic storytelling experience, mm-hmm. which is what a lot of the blurbs on it imply, you are going to be greatly disappointed. It's not a bad game. It's a great game. Yes. But that mixed expectation can lead to disappointment. And mm-hmm. and I'm like, how the heck do you get around that? How do you figure out ahead of time unless it's going and reading reviews from people? I can't think of how else to get around it.
And part of the reason why she chose Sherlock is because her love of the character and the stories. And that's where we get into the licenses. So yeah. A lot of games are able to use licenses, and that may mislead people into thinking a game is very different than it is. Yes. Examples we have reviewed and talked about recently are the My Little Pony Deck Builder, which is not a kid's game, or similarly, the Disney Sidekicks, which is actively not a children's game.
Yes.
Not even with parents helping is that one a children's game. Another one we've talked about recently is Dungeon Pets, which seems like it could be a little more lighter fun. You know, a lot of dungeon building video games out these days. And it's a Euro. It's it's got some weight to it. We've talked about that a few times recently. And then I think there's lots of other games out there. I mean, even something like Battlestar Galactica, as out of date as it is now, that game itself can have some mismatched expectations if you aren't familiar with what that game is now. It's old enough now that you probably have got no excuse, but I'm sure when that game came out, there were people picking up that game because, oh, I love DSG, and then getting mm-hmm. it home and going, oh, wait, what the heck is this thing?
So, yeah, I would say licensed games, that's a huge red flag. I have to stop and look this game up before I go any farther, because even if it's a license that's an adult license, sometimes they just really skip it on to something that's dead simple. Yes. And it's just pasted on. And kids' license can be for adults. Adult licenses can actually be pasted on a kid's game. And yeah, just when you're looking at a license game, do extra research.
Yeah, the licenses are scared. Like the main reason, what I was thinking when I got this is like, just because it's a Star Wars game doesn't mean it's a good game. Fantasy Flight does some fantastic Star Wars games. Milton Bradley does some horrible Star Wars games. Right. Just as two sides of a coin. There's currently two really hot Star Wars card games out there. They are very different from each other. Just because it's a Star Wars card game doesn't even necessarily. Sorry, there's three popular because there's also Bounty Hunters now. So Star Wars, the deck building game, there's Star Wars Unlimited and Star Wars Bounty Hunters, all put out under Asmodee's umbrella, all out at the same time. The main thing with these is, like, you got to do your research on a licensed game. Do not just go, oh, it's a Firefly game. It'll be about, don't make assumptions based on the license. There are enough of these licensed games where the license, once you sit down and play the game, have absolutely nothing to do with what you're doing in the game. And then others where they're really well tied in. It kind of goes both ways. But, like, seriously, a licensed game is a red flag. Like you cannot, never judge a game by its license.
Don't expect to sit down and play Labyrinth and find a game.
Another thing, now, this is somewhere somewhat adjacent to licenses, is non-licensed but I easily identifiable characters. The Brothers Grimm, yeah. Sheriff of Nottingham is a game that has confused a lot of people because they expect a Robin Hood game, and that game actually has nothing to do with Robin Hood. You take turns playing the sheriff, taxing the town. So it's not just those big licenses that you have to worry about. In fact, it may actually almost be worse if it's a public domain identity that is easily accessible, because anyone can slap it onto anything and no one is managing it. But on
Sheriff of Nottingham is a Robin Hood themed game, and now there's even a Disney Robin Hood.
Yeah, the Disney one is actually Robin Hood, but there's no
Robin the other Hood one's in, Robin Hood too
in the game.
You're smuggling goods. You're a bandit smuggling goods past the sheriff. It's a licensed game.
Well, okay, hold on. It's an IP game, but it's not licensed because Robin Hood is in the public domain.
Well, yes, that's
the Disney version. The
Disney version is licensed.
Yeah, yeah.
Because everyone was like, why isn't there a Disney version?
Another one, and now in the opposite realm, some of the Lords of the Rings card games have looked really kind of boring and not all that interesting, but turned out to be fantastic games. And so there are certain Lord of the Rings card games out there where it's like people might pass them by as like, oh, that looks about as boring as reading the Silmarillion, when in fact, there's a real game there that's interesting. The opposite mismatched expectation.
So we've recently played a Lord of the Rings game that was pretty terrible. So again, you can't judge a game by its license. You need to do more research. Now, another one I watch for is look at the playtime on the box. No matter what the art looks like, no matter what you think the game's about, if it says it's going to be over an hour, it is not a light, silly game. It is not a party game. It is not going to be quick. If you're looking at over 90 minutes, expect meaty, like expect heavy, expect a couple hours your first play. And if you see anything over 120 minutes, assume epic game night where you have to set aside a weekend and call your friends to play. So while you might have the cute game with woodland creatures on the box and that four-letter title we were talking about, check the playtime. Because Root says 90-minute playtime, and that alone should be enough to kind of warn you, right? It's just to warn you to the this may not be what you expect unless that's what you're looking for. And the opposite is true, too. Like, you grab a Lord of the Rings game, and you're expecting to play out, you know, the entire Lord of the Ring, and you flip it over, and it says playtime 15 minutes. You're like, ooh, wait a minute. Or you've got, you know, War of 1873, the full invasion, and the box says playtime 15 minutes. You're not going to play through an epic campaign, right? You're not going to get a simulation. You're probably going to get a super quick card game that may just be a variant of war.
So there's some chatter in the chat right now about game times being a lie. And while I don't necessarily disagree with that, I think there is a kind of a break point. So for me, I look at the 60-minute mark. If it's under 60 minutes, it's going to be a quick, shorter game. If it says 60 minutes, that means anything above 60 minutes. It could be a 90-minute game. And if it says 90 minutes or more, you know you're in for the long slog. So I may not believe that when it says 60 minutes, it's a 60-minute game, but I know you're definitely looking at a longer hunk of game as soon as you see it written 60 on the box, whether or not it's actually a 60-minute game. And we all know first game is going to go.
Well, the other thing to be aware of is that time on the box does not include setup. It does not include takedown. It does not include passing out cards or setting up. It counts game starts to game end, and sometimes doesn't include adding up the final score, because by then the game's done, as we've talked about in the past. A lot of people forget about that. They sit and go, we played this for 2 hours, but you don't realize it took you 45 minutes to get going, and it took you 15 minutes clean up, and literally you only played for that hour. So it's something a lot of people aren't aware of. Yes, I think board game boxes should include setup and takedown time. That's a totally different argument. But all I'm saying is just watch that, right? If you're picking one of the things to check, right? I'm picking up this expansion for Scythe, and I'm like, oh, it looks like it's about cool airships. We're going to do all this stuff. And then I look, and it's got a playtime on here. And you're like, whoa, wait a minute. This is an hour and 20 minutes. Scythe's only a 90-minute game. This is going to make my games way longer, right? That's the kind of thing you're watching for. You grab that Disney Sidekicks game, and you see a playtime of 1 hour. You're like, oh, maybe this isn't the light romp dice chucker with cool minis that I thought it was going to be.
Absolutely. Although, to be fair, you can get into something like Monopoly, which has, you know, hour plus long times and isn't a big meaty game. So,
yeah.
Again, there's always going to be, you know, exceptions to every rule. But for me, I personally look for that 60 minute mark. But over or under that 60 minute mark is a very telling thing I find from publishers.
I was trying to think if universally I could say any one publisher is better about this than another, but I think they all kind of, they're all across the board.
So that was the next one I wanted to bring up, which kind of goes with licensed games, is don't necessarily trust that a designer or publisher, because they make one game, the next game's going to be like it. And I see a lot of fans doing this where they're like, you know, because this is put out by this company, I expect it to be the same as this game I already enjoy. And they're not. And I'm failing on specific examples off the top of my head at this time, but I know it's been an issue. Like back in the Mayfair Games day, when we were buying the Aaliyah games, they were all kind of similar, right? Like you got Princes of Florence and you got Medici and you got, there was at least a similar, they're all Euro games feel, but then you'd suddenly open up something like Las Vegas and you're like, what's this push your luck dice gambling game? So it's just like.
That King Arthur one with the swords and the dial Arturus.
I think a perfect example of this that we sort of saw at Origins is Queen City Games. We love Queen City Games. They put out some fantastic stuff. But if you look at Marrakesh, and you look at Double Walla, those are vastly different games. Yes. They're both thinky, hard games, but the level, the time involved, the level of sort of game there is going to be, sorry, did I say Queen City?
Yes.
Sorry, Queen Games. Queen Games. But yeah, like the difference between Double Walla and Marrakesh is night and day. While there are similarities,
look at that Power Lines game we played, which plays in about 15 minutes, right? Yeah. Like Queen is all over the place. Mm-hmm. Now, another example is also that kind of goes with this is groupings. I don't know what you call it, but Valeria. Just because it's a Valeria game does not mean it plays the same as every Valeria game. Now, you will have the same icons. You will probably have four guilds. You'll have certain colors. There'll probably be some randomness involved, but it's going to be a very different game than the last Valeria game
you played. If you grab that trick-taking one and you're expecting to play Card Kingdoms of Valeria, you're going to be pretty disappointed.
Yeah.
At this point, like, those are some of the red flags. Do you have any more red flags before we move on to ways to kind of mitigate this? We kind of worked some in as we're already going. Excuse me. The other thing is just watch out for hype. What is it? Conjecture. What's the other? Exaggeration. I'm forgetting the word.
Marketing. Marketing exists to sell you a product, whether you need it or not.
I like to me, a red flag is always buy gamers for gamers. I'm like, you're in the hobby game market. Like, that's assumed. If you have to call that out, you're saying something there, that your game's probably overly complicated and simulationist is usually what that means to me. But there are other buzzwords in the industry, the quick to play, difficult to master. We hear it 100 times. There are very few games I think actually fit that well. Deanna could mention one just to include it in the episode. But
I mean, Zensu. Yes, it's actually true with Zensu.
It's actually true with Zensu. But like, I've seen a number of those, right? Or I don't know, whatever, the party game that will do this thing for you, make you popular, whatever, that kind of stuff's out there.
Yeah. I mean, even great games, like, we love Gloomhaven, but it kind of gets sold as a dungeon crawler, and that's really not what Gloomhaven is. I don't think
Cephalofair tries to sell it that way, but I think other people just kind of
assumed. Some of the imagery around the game gives that feeling. Cephalofair does not state anything outright, and again, none of these companies, I think, are malicious in their marketing. But they give opinion, they give ideas, and they give thoughts. And there is definitely an aspect of Gloomhaven that gives you a concept of dungeon crawling without being a dungeon crawler.
So I think it is a dungeon crawler. So I can't really argue the other side of that one, because I think it is a dungeon crawler. It's not a dice chuck and move your mini dungeon crawler. It's a action economy hand-based dungeon crawler. Just a different style of it to me.
Resource management.
Yeah, resource hand management more so than resources.
Much like Root, I think Gloomhaven is become popular enough that everyone knows what they're getting into there. Yeah. But I think when it first came out, I think we talked about it a lot when it first came out when it was new, that there was definitely mixed expectations there.
But again, that's the one that must have worked, isn't it? The number one game on Board Game Geek again, or still, like, it's definitely popular. So I think people wanted HeroQuest and got Gloomhaven, but then decided they liked it. So some of the things you can do, it seems silly, but go to Board Game Geek. Like, Board Game Geek has a lot of information. The big thing to watch for, though, is the stuff that's there by the users. Board Game Geek is a bunch of alpha gamers. It's a bunch of people. They're game buyers. They're game collectors. They're people who are obsessed with board games. Make accounts there. Your average Joe who just plays games on game nights and plays other people's copies of games isn't on there, right? So the people who are rating these games care a lot about them. That's what you want to look for. So, like, you don't want to look at the player count on the box. Look at the suggested player count on Board Game Geek. Don't look at the weight on the box if there's anything explaining what the weight of the box is. Again, look for the weight on Board Game Geek. Look at the suggested numbers by fans. The play times on Board Game Geek are a lot more accurate than the ones on the box. That's what I use when I run tournaments. When I am running an Extra Life tournament or a Great Canadian Board Game Blitz, I use the times on Board Game Geek. Now, I do add 15 minutes minimum to half an hour to each of them. Again, for that setup, play time, and the fact we have a round where people have to pick which games to play. But the times there are way more accurate. You will look it up, and stuff like Twilight Imperium says 8 hours. Now, again, these are players who know how to play the games. It's not your first time playing the game you're going to get that down. But it's not the whatever I don't know, 160 minutes or whatever it says on the box.
Now, that being said, there are also some caveats to using Board Game Geek, particularly with the new hotness. So if a game is just coming out, if a game is just on Kickstarter, if it's going to be the new hotness at Essen or at Gen Con, take a look at the number of readings.
Yes.
That is the very first thing I look at anytime I pull up a Board Game Geek page is the number of ratings. If there are less than about 500 ratings, I take everything on that page with a grain of salt.
Yeah.
As soon as it gets over 500 ratings, it's all, you know, the average law of averages have taken over and you're settling into some reality there. Mm-hmm. But if you're under 500, that's where you get the Kickstarter vote blocking and rate and, you know, hate ranking and all these people, you know, the metagamers who just are playing with the Board Game Geek system more than the game itself. So do watch out for those lower ranked games that haven't been ranked enough yet. And let some of the noise work itself out.
Yeah, you're pickier than me. I go with a number that's lower than 500, but then there's a number that's low enough where you're like, I think you just got all your family and friends to go in and rate this game. It doesn't count yet.
Yes.
One of the things I was thinking about as a red flag is when those suggested times and weights and player counts on Board Game Geek are wildly different from what's on the box. That is an indication that maybe things just aren't jiving there.
No, exactly. That's why you do it. The other place you can find out is listen to people like us who play games and tell you about the games we play.
Yep.
Check out stuff from reviewers, right? Like listen to podcasts, read written reviews.
Listen to reviewers. The other place you can look, we know things.
Yeah. The other place you can look is people like us, right? Like people who talk about games and who know games. Ask the local Alpha gamer. Ask the owner of your friendly local game store. Listen to podcasts, check out YouTube channels, watch a how to play, go to the big names, go to us, whatever. That's what we're here for. That's one of the services we provide, is letting you know about the games we played so that you can make a good decision about whether they're for you or not, which is why we always include in all of our reviews, talk about who we think the game is for, even if it's not for us.
And even if we don't have a review, feel free to reach out and maybe not even us. Reach out to your favorite reviewers, reach out to people whose opinions you have trusted on other games and get them to do. Maybe, you know, one of us can hop on a Board Game Geek and do a deeper analysis of the stats we see there. Mm-hmm. We can reach out to other friends in the industry, other people in the industry that we know who may have had their hands on the game, even if we haven't. So just because we don't have an active review out there doesn't mean we can't answer those questions for you.
And actually, Charlie Brown Windsor brings something up that actually fits with that and Board Game Geek. Be aware of something where everything's lowing, that like all reviews are 5-star. It does happen. There are some almost universally good games out there. There are games that pretty much every reviewer is going to rate well because it's that good. And many reviewers like us try to avoid, like we vet what comes in, right? We try to make sure we're going to like a game before we actually play it. Sometimes we're surprised. But that is generally the goal. But yeah, if everything's overwhelmingly positive, and the other thing to watch is make sure the people you are listening to and reading are disclosing. You do have to make a difference and tell the difference between advertisement and actual review.
Yeah, if you look at the number one game on Board Game Geek right now, it's still only an 8.6.
Yeah.
So if you see something that's 9, it hasn't got enough reviews yet.
Probably. Well, to be fair, 8 is like, I will always enjoy playing this game. Like getting up to 9 and 10 is just like, if you're using their actual rating scale, again, we're not going to talk about rating scales on Board Game Geek. We've ranted about that one before. I can do it again if you want in the lobby, but use the dang ratings that are there. Don't come up with your own system. There's a reason they're there. There, I put it out there anyway.
Only the top 16 games on all of Board Game Geek are rated 8 or above.
Yeah,
16 games out of however many tens of thousands of games are on Board Game Geek are actually rated above an 8.
So the next one, this is honestly the best way to find out if a game's right, is try it before you buy it. Like you really can't beat sitting down and actually playing a game. Now, thankfully, nowadays, there's lots of ways to do this, right? You can go to a con, you can go to local gaming events, you can go to your friendly local game store and ask them to do a demo. You can, again, ask your local alpha gamers, the people who buy the game buyers. or just go online. There are so many games online right now. You can go on Board Game Arena, being our favorite of the sites. There are other sites. There's Tabletop Simulator. There's all kinds of ways to try before you buy nowadays. Pretty much every successful Kickstarter now, every successful board game gets prototyped on Tabletop Simulator or one of those virtual tabletops. Even the best publishers we work with put their games out there first. That is a great way to try before you buy. Find a way. Like, you have to be pretty remote, and the game's got to be pretty obscure and not to be able to find at least some way to try a game before you buy it.
BGA, if the game is on BGA, that is my favorite way to filter out and see if it matches what I think it's going to do. Even if I don't play through a full game, I can just, you know, see the layout, go through it, get a good look at it, and get a good feeling for if it is what I thought it was by looking at the back of the box.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Tabletop Simulator is a favorite of a lot of designers and prototypers. The problem that we've always had with Tabletop Simulator is you have to learn Tabletop Simulator in order to get the most out of it. So you have to, there's a level of knowledge required before you can get to the level knowledge of the game. So while it definitely has its place, if you aren't already a Tabletop Simulator user and you know, comfortable, it has its drawbacks.
Now, another thing to do is watch for awards, award winners, nominations, whatever. They're usually right on the box. The Spieljar, to me, is actually one of the best ones because it separates games into three categories: kids games, family games, and gamers games. And just seeing where they classify games has totally changed my mind on games, where I'm like, oh, Dwarf Romantic, I thought that was going to be, you know, a lightweight game. That's in the Kenner? Oh, wow. Okay, I need to check that out, right? So that's a good one, is the Spiel, to kind of get an idea of the game weight as well as if people are enjoying it. Now, Mensa stickers, those ones have misled me, so I don't trust them, because the Mensa ones, you expect like heavy brain burning games because it's Mensa, but you often just get like cute little quirky games that are kind of gimmicky end up winning that award. And I get it now that I know how Mensa runs their awards, but just awards in general, like I know we talked at the start of the show, we had a bit of a chat about awards and how useful they are and how the judgments are made and everything like that. The thing an award will do is it will get me to look at a game I might not have even noticed. To me, the award is the, hey, check this out, there might be something worth looking at.
Yeah, I think the big thing for I try to watch out for is if they're putting the nominee on there and not the award. So I was nominated for a Mensa Award. Well, great. We're 300 other games. It depending on the category. Now, if you're an awards or a nominee, there's only 5 games in a category. But if you're a Mensa Award nominee, there's a lot of games that are nominated for that. And knowing the difference and understanding all the different awards, again, like what was saying, the process of going through to in order to determine the winner of a Mensa game is weird. It's not what people normally think of. It's a very different sort of experience than the sort of voting you get in an Origins Award, which is within the industry, or the Spiel des Jahres, which is its own thing, and the Golden Geeks.
It's another good one.
These there are some big ones out there which a lot of people understand and are voted about the way people understand. And then there's others, like there's the Grauroku or the Goldor or Mensa, which aren't as necessarily as familiar. Yeah. And so pause and read about the award before you assume anything about it.
But all of that aside, just that award is like an extra tag that I can use to filter it to see if it meets the expectations or not.
Yeah,
I totally get. I wanted to talk about, if you're at an event or a game night, you just ask before you're going to sit down and play the game. Like, you can go to the host and say, okay, you just put out this game that's got cute little critters on it, and I thought we were here to play a war game. What's going on? Is this what I came here for or not? You know, so ask up front and find out if you're going to be locking yourself into the table with the game you thought you were or not.
Absolutely. Yeah. Someone could put out Battle Sheep and you think it's just a little kid's game, when actually you're going to be tearing each other apart on that table.
Yeah. Battle Sheep's a good example of one. There was something.
Our kids loved Battle Sheep, though.
Yeah.
It is a good kid's game.
It is.
But when you put it down in front of adults, it is definitely a cutthroat, harsh game to play.
Hey, That's My Fish is another example of that one. Mm-hmm. Though I don't know if that's mixed expectations with, hey, that's my fish. For some reason, that's kind of what I expected from that one. But Battleship was definitely, I'm like, blue orange games kind of looks like a Haba little kids game with these like chunky pieces and silly art. And you're just like, oh, this is just evil game. One of the most evil area majority games ever.
I think the new printing of Hey, That's My Fish may look a little less that way. But the version, the older version we have, definitely has a really kiddie vibe to the box. And when we put it out at public play events, I keep reassuring people, this is not actually a kid's game. It's actually pretty cutthroat. Give it a shot. I think you'll like it.
Yeah. So,
and then the other thing, too, is here's the other side of things. If you are at an event or a game night and you see someone grab something and you just look and go, you know, they're thinking the wrong thing about that game. Stop them and point it out, please. Like, just something to be nice to do. We stopped bringing the My Little Pony deck building game out to public play events because every kid who has ever shown up is drawn to it. And little girls are grabbing the game and hugging it and carrying it away from the table. And the parents are going, oh, let's go. And I'm like, I'm sorry. I can teach you to play this game, but it's not going to be enjoyable for the little one. Here's what it's about. And there's six resources and it's engine building and there's a ton of reading required. And they're like, oh, okay, we'll put that back. Like, I'm all for people trying. My kids love the game. They're a little older, but like, I'm sure some families are perfectly great with that game. I'm not trying to say it's terrible, but the mixed expectation is there. So every time we see someone grab that game, we have to say stop. And like I said, it was enough that we no longer even bring the game. I know Boop has had the same problem with smaller children.
Yeah, I don't put Boop.
Boop we keep there because Boop
but it's on the back of those the table. It's not on the edge of the table anymore.
Yes, we put it further in so the kids can't grab it and walk away with it.
So a couple of red flags that have come up here in the chat room. Major Caleb points out with the licensing theme, you know, especially if there's big blockbuster movies, if something is there in the public conscience, there are probably going to be a number of games coming out, and that confuses the market because someone might say, hey, have you checked out the Labyrinth game? It's great. And you go to the store and you buy the Labyrinth game and it's not even a game because they were talking about this 1947 German game called Labyrinth and you were thinking about David Bowie. You really have to sort of do your research, especially when you've got that big IP, that big licensed content, and everyone is rushing to market to try and capitalize on that.
As a recent example, Stranger Things. How many Stranger Things board games were released? And I've heard some are good. I've heard some aren't so great. I have not played any of them to make a judgment. And if I was going to go, someone said, oh, did you play the new Stranger Things game? I have no clue which one you're talking about. I'm like, the one that looks like an Eggo box, the one from Cool Mini with the two sides, or the D&D starter set. Like, there were so many different Stranger Things things that came out.
Yeah. Another one Major Killer brings up is how much stuff you're getting. While there are certain companies who we know and we can trust that if they're putting a lot of stuff in the box, they've put some thought into it. Simon, for example, generally, if they're you know, there's going to be a lot of stuff in the box and there's probably a use for it. Sure, you may get a giant table sized Cthulhu that you don't actually need. But for the most part, you know, there's a lot of cool stuff in there. Whereas a lot of lesser known publishers or unknown publishers may be trying to pack components in to make up for lack of gameplay, or they may be packing it in there because they think that's what makes the gameplay and just not understanding their own game or the market or really game development in general. This is a bigger problem on Kickstarter than if you go into your FLGS. But these days, a lot of FLGSs are doing purchasing on Kickstarter as well. Mm-hmm. So it's at least something to be aware of. If you've got one of those giant mini heavy component heavy games, take an extra long look at it and see if all those components really make the game better or just heavier.
Yeah, look for expansions, right? If a game has a lot of expansions, it makes me question what's wrong with the base game. Why did they need to add all this stuff to it? In some cases, it works, right? Like Horizon Zero Dawn's got a bunch of expansions because it adds new beasts and new hunts, but the gameplay stays the same. other games overdo it with a bunch of stuff you don't need, right? Like, I'm like, are you trying to sell this game to the miniature collectors or for the people that want the board game or both? And there is a perception because of a few extremely successful Kickstarters early on that that's what you need is more stuff, more stretch goals, more rewards, or else you won't make your money.
Yeah, and we've called this up before, and this is really more of a Kickstarter thing. Stretch goals can be a red flag. Any stretch goals can be a red flag. You know, if the game is solid, you sell the game. And, you know, if you really want to stretch goal for some t-shirts or something, that's another red flag. But, you know, adding some marketing stuff onto your stretch goals is one thing. But the game should be the game. The game should not be part of the stretch goals.
And we got a whole episode about that. So we'll stop talking about crowdfunding. Yeah. This is for games on the store shelf or when you're browsing your online game store of your choice.
We didn't even touch on box size.
Yes,
that's true. That's a hard one.
The problem with box size is I get it, right? Like the box needs shelf space to there's a value to size to cost factor.
It's almost as much as shipping air upsets me, the where the box is bigger than it needs to be is almost the opposite of a mismatched expectation. They're trying to give you the right expectation by showing you this is actually a chunky game. If we put it in a tiny box, the smallest size we could possibly, you wouldn't take it seriously. So it's trying to meet expectations.
Right. Yeah. And honestly, I guess that's another red flag, right? Like watch what you get. Check the contents on the box. Don't judge what you're going to get by the size of the box.
Yeah. The fact that you grab a box and go, oh, this is lighter than I expected. Flip it over and read that component list. Read what's inside. So understand why it's lighter than it should be. And, you know, maybe you want maybe that the fact that it's lighter means you want to take a minute and do some research before you go and grab it. Bring it up to the counter. Ask whoever's there who's working there about this game. Is it just a lot of air, but it's still a really good game? Or is it a whole lot of hot air altogether? One thing Roger does mention, if you are especially on Tabletop Simulator, using Tabletop Simulator to check out a game, make sure it's been updated. Sometimes they may have prototyped it on Tabletop Simulator, but not carried it all the way through. They may have done their prototyping and then gone on elsewhere. The game has advanced, so the final game that you would be getting may not match that prototype on Tabletop Simulator.
Now, here's one for the alpha gamers out there. If you really want to know if a game's going to be for you, especially if it's something being hyped that's coming soon, you can contact the publisher and ask about playtesting it. Many publishers have Discords. Many of those Discords have ways to sign up to playtest their latest games. Then you get to know right from the start if it's for you or not. And if it's not, make sure you tell them why.
Ahau, Rulers of Yucatán from Grand Gamers Guild is a Euro-style board game combining elements of worker placement and resource management with innovative dual engine building all set in the classical period of the Maya.
Ahau is a homage to the breathtaking Maya culture, bringing their history to the players. The culture and historical aspects of the game were closely checked by a Mayanist David S. Anderson, professor of anthropology and archaeology.
Ahau has great table presence with 3D pyramids, historically accurate illustrations, wooden resources, and workers. Gameplay involves picking which area of the map to go to each turn. There, you're going to collect pyramid tiles, gain resources, build buildings, and potentially even summon the Mayan gods.
For the 2024 convention season, Mark from Grand Gamers Guild has marked Ahau down to just $50 US, and he's going to have copies available at GenCon at this reduced price. So if you head over to booth 2838 and tell them the Tabletop Bellhop sent you.
Not going to Gen Con? It's all good. You can also get the game for $50 at Grand Gamers Guild. As a bonus to our fans, you can use the exclusive code Bellhop to save 10%, which should help you a bit with the shipping. All right, well, we've got a couple of things coming up that everyone should know about.
First up, we won't be recording a podcast next week. Amazon Prime Day sales are next week, so we're going to be busy sharing the best deals on board games, card games, and RPGs. Watch our website for a landing page and be sure to check out the Tabletop Gaming Deals social media accounts for a stream of great game deals.
Next, come see us at The Summoning. This is a new entertainment convention here in Windsor. First ever Summoning will be happening on July 20th at St. Clair College. There are a ton of cool things happening, including many trading card games and esports tournaments with over $16,000 in prizes, cornhole, cosplay, local vendors, and more.
We'll be there running the board game area, which will feature a menu of free-to-play games. In addition, we've got a handful of our favorite games that will be play to win. Play the games at any point during the event, and you could go home with it at the end of the day. Now, you must be present at the end of the event to win. The games that are up for grabs include Go Cuckoo, Raiders of the North Sea, Catch the Moon, Lost Ruins of Arnak, Wormspan, and more. Find more through the link in the show notes, which we also are going to drop in the chat.
Following the Summoning, on July 25th, that's going to be our next Brews and Boards Games event at the Walkerville Brewery, where we will continue to highlight some of the cool stuff we brought back from Origins. This is a free, family-friendly event, though we do encourage everyone to support the venue by grabbing food and drink.
Also, since we're talking announcements and cancellations, just an early heads up that we will not be recording on August the 14th. At that time, we'll be up north with the family on our annual end of summer trip to my uncle's farm.
Now it's time for the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games that we've been playing lately.
All right, last week wasn't quite as busy as the week before, but we did get in some gaming. Actually, quite a few game nights, but a lot of the same games played on multiple days. First up was Centurion from Catalyst Game Labs. Talked about this a lot the last couple weeks. This is the newest game in the Duke series. Finally let Deanna try it because I know she's been itching to play it. And Sean even gave it a go this past weekend. So did it live up to expectations?
So I think for me, it's interesting. It's very Duke-like in some ways, but it's a much more slow take game. And I don't want to say plotting, but at times maybe a little bit. And that gives it a different mood to me than the Duke. I still haven't played Jarl, or maybe I played it once, so I can't compare it to the Jarl. But compared to the Duke, this definitely feels like a slower, more methodical game.
Yeah, I'm really digging this one. Every time we play it, I want to play again. And even though the games have gone long, I found super enjoyable. Like, sure, it's over an hour, but I'm enjoying every minute of that hour. And I actually think this is my new favorite have a beer and play a game. And Mo and I were talking about this. Now, I haven't played Jarl in like a couple years, so it's not very clear and crisp in my mind. And maybe I have to go back and play it and compare. But when I played Jarl versus the Duke, I did not enjoy it. I was just like, forget this game. Let's go back and play the Duke. I played this and I was like, Duke is also good, but we can just put the Duke on the back burner for a while and only play Centurion and I would be perfectly happy. So
the main thing I'm hearing is we all three of us need to play Jarl again and figure out if it's just like the Highlander 2 of Duke games or if there's something there we missed the first time. Now, I think when we played Jarl before, we played the defense icon wrong. Only learning that because the clarifications in Centurion and the difference between the shield and the defense icon made me go, wait, I think we're using defense as shields in the old game. And I think that would totally change it because the problem I remember having with the old game was too much shields, too many shield maidens and ways to defend and almost impenetrable defenses because I think we were playing that wrong. So it'd be interesting to know.
And I didn't even talk about like there's this cool formation thing where you can make multiple pieces move. I really like that. And I like how that leads to some surprising moves. Even when you think you're really paying attention, I can surprise myself by going, oh, heck, wait, I can do that. Or, you know, my opponent can surprise me by going, oh, heck, they can do that. So I enjoy that aspect.
Sometimes you play a game because it's there. I for some reason, our copy of The Mind was sitting on our kitchen table when Deanna and I got home from a night out. So we played. I still dig it. I don't know if I'm terrible at it or D and I together are terrible at it. We are not good at The Mind. I think we got to level 6, maybe somewhere around there out of 13. It wasn't good. We definitely did not win. The only thing I'd say about it is, yes, it's a game. And if you don't think so, check out episode 245. What makes a game from a few weeks ago?
Yeah, all right. My feelings on this one remain unchanged, and I can vouch for the fact of why you will lose, because I am on your team in the mind. I think the mind is an interesting exercise. I know, by our definition of a game, it does fit into the category of a game, but to me, it's just like an interesting exercise. It's unique. Everyone should play it once and then just put it away. Move on.
Next up was a punching party where Sean and I opened up all of our play to win games for the summoning and made quite a mess.
And this event proved that, as we discussed last week, Dumbbot games really, really should have a box insert.
Yeah, it was sheer chaos. I got up on a chair and took a reel, like aimed down at the mess, and there's just cardboard and plastic everywhere. And it was only 7 games. It's not like we were punching, you know, 42 games to get them ready, but it was an impressive amount of chaos.
And even those 7 games, most of them didn't have a lot. It was 2 games in particular that had an awful lot of cardboard and tokens. And those would be Lost Ruins of Arnak and Wyrmspan. If we could have left those off the table, like Go Cuckoo, there was 1 plastic bag, you know?
Yep.
Gorinto, yeah, there was some extra size bags, but not much else, you know? But Lost Ruins of Arnak, I forgot how much stuff and punch boards and lack of any organization whatsoever in that box.
Well, and unfortunately, Wyrmspan suffers from the same problem. And I know Jamie has gone on and said, you know, well, we wanted to give people the option to do whatever they wanted with it. Well, some guidance would have been a little helpful on how to put that thing away.
So speaking of mixed expectations, to stick with our topic tonight, if you are expecting the deluxe upgrades and organization you found in Wingspan to be in Wyrmspan, you will be disappointed. Now, after all of the punching, we decided we could use a refresher on one of the 7 games, which was Raiders of the North Sea. So we played a full game. It's not an overly long game. I still dig it. I adore the new mechanic there. They place a worker, take a worker. Place a worker, do what you where you placed. Take a worker, do where you take it from. Unless you're raiding, then it's just place a worker, roll some dice. I love that mechanic. It was nice to get this classic back to the table. It still stands up. It wasn't one of those, you know, I played this whole game and I'm like, oh, this was a product of its time. I'm like, no, it's fantastic.
We often don't tend to go back to the older games in our collection, and I was super excited to have an excuse to play this one again, as it's definitely a favorite of mine. And this let us cross the game off the Sean Must playlist. So what did you think of Raiders, Sean?
So I have to say I was a little bit anxious because it was late enough in the night that I know that at a certain time, brain burny games give me problems. But it really isn't as thinky as I expected. I think what really makes the difference for me is, I mean, yes, the mechanic is great and straightforward. Take a meeple or put a meeple, take a meeple. But the fact that the deck of Vikings gives you that random aspect takes some of the thinking out of it. It's not that perfect information, you know, Steffenfeld style brain burner. There's enough randomness in there and there's enough sort of competition of playing off each other. You don't know whether or not someone else is going to take the spot you need or leaving it, you know. I think it was less difficult than I expected and more fun than I expected all at the same time.
Yeah, it's a medium weight, right? Like it's almost a next step game. It's not gateway, but it's pretty simple to pick up without all the expansions. We just played the base game. The expansions do add that some more complexity to it. Next were some plays at Brenda's place where we started off Cartographer's Heroes with the 6th math expansion, the Hornhelm Wasteland Market. Went over pretty well. We also played that with Sean just yesterday at a local coffee shop. I'm digging the expansion, but I'm going to save more of my thoughts because we're going to review this one as the last review of the show.
I liked it. I felt like it's just more of the same. I mean, if you like Cartographers, you're going to dig this expansion.
Yeah, still a fun game. Only comment is dark art, and you'll hear more about that in the review.
Sunday, we also introduced Skull King to Brenda and Genevieve. This is from Grandpa Beck's Games. This is a game that I got to thank our chat room here on Twitch for recommending I get, because every time we talk about Thrones of Valyria and Xylotar and other trick takers, someone will speak up and say, well, how's it compared to Skull King? Well, we're finding it out. This is a really solid game. I love bidding games like this, where the one card, two card, three card, and I really like spades. So there's a lot to like in this for me. I was pretty sure Brenda would enjoy this one. And it's always nice when we're like, oh, she'll enjoy this. And she does. So that always feels good.
I've been surprised by how much I've enjoyed this game. I think I was kind of, this is one I was lukewarm on getting a review copy for. Like, you wanted to pick it up and I didn't. And I've actually really been enjoying it. It's just a really solid trick taker. Jen loved it, and I was amused by her enthusiasm. Like, she was even talking to me about it later. She's like, that's one of the best games. And I'm like, yeah, it is, isn't it?
Now, at this point, we've only played with the default scoring, and we haven't used any of the optional rules. Like there's a thing where all, each of the pirates has a different ability, and you can throw in treasure, and there's a white whale, and the Kraken. We haven't even touched any of that stuff. So because of that, and the fact I want to try it with more players, it plays up to 8. I would love to see how well it plays at 8. I did notice Board Game Geek says best at 6, but it'd be interesting to see it at 8. So what I need to do is we need to remember to put this on the menu for our next Brews and Board Games event later this month, and then try to get a big group playing if we can.
Yeah, this game's going to be great for public play. Anyone who digs traditional trick takers needs to play this one. Come on, we got your mom to play it, right? Yep. So I mean, that right there means like this is the game to bring in traditional card players too. Yes. So I think it'll do really good at public play. I'm looking forward to checking that out.
Well, that's it for what we've been playing. What about you? What's at your table? Tell us in the comments, or better yet, head to Discord, our Discord, the Tabletop Bellhop Discord, at discord.tabletopbellhop.com.
Caution Signs is a fantastic mashup of drawing party game and deduction game. No, not social deduction, just deduction. As in, trying to figure out what each drawn sign represents.
This one comes from the new family game imprint of Wise Wizard Games, known as Wacky Wizard Games, who we have to thank for letting us take a review copy home from Origins.
Caution Signs was designed by Danielle Reynolds and Scott Boop Brady and was just released to Origins a couple of weeks ago. You should be able to get it everywhere great games are sold.
You need at least 3 players for this party game to work, and it plays up to 9. The rules are dead simple, and the game is great fun for players of almost any age. While one round of the game is over in minutes, a full game where each player gets to be the guesser once or twice can take a half hour or more.
So what is Caution Signs all about? Well, each turn, one player is the guesser. The other players are sketchers. They're each given 2 cards, one descriptor card from the caution deck and one subject card from the sign deck. They also get a dry erase caution sign, you know, the yellow signs. They look at these cards and then have 20 seconds to draw a caution sign based on their 2 cards.
Once the time is up, the cards are collected and 2 random cards from each deck are added to the pile. These are mixed thoroughly and then given to the guesser, who now has to try to deduce what each sign represents.
Points are awarded based on how accurate the guesser's guesses are. Continue playing until each player has been the guesser twice, unless playing 6 or more players. In that case, each player gets to be the guesser once. Or treat this like the party game it is and stop when you're sick of it. Don't worry too much about the points.
Now, we first got to try a prototype of Caution Signs at Gamma Expo earlier this year, and I was immediately hooked. I wanted to take home a copy right then and there after being taught the game by Danielle and playing with members of the Wise Wizard team. Sadly, all they had at the trade show was a single prototype copy that they weren't willing to give up.
Well, it was still pretty cool that we got to play the prototype copy.
True enough. Now, fast forward to Origins, and there's Danielle in the Wise Wizard booth running her game over and over for people. I can't remember a time that we walked by that booth where there wasn't at least one group playing Caution Signs, usually at 2, and I think at one point they had it on multiple tables. And everyone we saw playing this was super into it. We picked up our copy on Thursday and then played it the same night at the first ever Tabletop Bellhop Origins meetup, where it was a huge hit.
Yeah, you're right. Every time we walked by the booth, there was always people playing that game and they always looked like they were having a riot. It's a fun, silly game. Like, you just can't go wrong with this one. It's going to work with any crowd.
This is a game that, to me, proves more than anything that no drawing skill is required.
Yeah, this game just works, right? It's dead simple. People get the concept right away, and it pretty much plays exactly how you'd expect. It's the opposite of the games and problems we were talking about earlier this episode. This perfectly met my expectations and, well, maybe surpassed it because it's more fun than I thought it would be.
Now, there are some words in the deck that some people may not fully understand, especially younger players. Not everyone's vocabulary is the same, so do be aware. Like with any word-based game, it is something to be take note of just in case.
Yeah, and the designer was obviously aware of this because the rule book actually addresses this. Where there's rules for what happens if a sketcher doesn't know their word. And then there's a suggested way to play with younger kids where you go around on the table and say, hey, does everyone know their words? And if they don't, they just draw new ones.
Yeah, just that discreet, I don't know this one, let me swap. That keeps the game from breaking. And again, as with most of these party games, I don't care about the scoring at all.
One of the things that I think really makes Caution Signs work and even elevates it above some other drawing games is the super short time limit on drawing. 20 seconds is quick and honestly not enough time to draw anything well, which is why it works. By only giving 20 seconds to everyone, it really levels the playing field as far as drawing skill is concerned. With that little time, all you're trying to do is kind of get across the general impression, the gist, the kind of overall feel of what you're drawing. And I love it for that.
Yeah. So at first I really hated the short timer. Like the very first round we played of it. And I went, okay, no, this is awful. And I mean, we even fudged the rules and had it set for 30 seconds in our first game. And it still felt far too short. You need to make that realization that super short time, it is a feature, not a flaw. And it is what evens the playing field between people like our eldest kid who can draw far too accurately and folks like myself who can barely manage a stick figure.
Yeah, this is undeniably the hardest part of the game. Most people have no idea just how short a time 20 seconds really is, especially when it includes reading and processing the cards you've been given as well. You need to process this fast and draw even faster. No details. There's no time for that. Broad strokes only.
Now, the other brilliant thing in Caution Signs is their choice of adjectives and nouns on the cards. At first, guessing and deduction seems pretty easy, but then you get around where the nouns are bear and panda in the same set, and you've got the adjectives cute and loving. The entire deduction system here is honestly what sets it apart from other drawing games and what really draws me to this game.
Yeah, it's that deduction part where you're looking at the signs and trying to figure out what matches where. And that's when the game truly gets amusing to me. And it also leads to things like, what the heck? How is that not a panda?
Now, there is some benefit from knowledge of the cards here. Knowing that cute and loving are both there means that you can think about how to draw one to differentiate. But don't take too much time thinking about that.
Yeah, the system mastery that you can get from this game does lead me to my only potential concern at all about Caution Signs, besides the usual problem of dry erase markers drying out and having to buy replacements. But that happens with every drawing game nowadays. I just worry that these clue cards may get repetitive. Like, we haven't actually seen this problem, but I have a very minor concern that if you play with the same group often enough, you might fall into the trap of, well, if there's hearts, that means loving, because that's what we always draw when we see the loving card.
I mean, that's going to be true with this style of game, but I think you have to play a ton. You would have to play a ton within a relatively short time span and with the exact same people before this would be a problem.
Yeah, and now, as with any card-driven drawing game, expansions will be easy to produce if they choose to. So, if this game goes over well, I'm sure we will see more content to help extend the life of the game and obviate some of these problems.
Overall, I love this drawing game. Like, there was a time for years where there was one drawing game in my collection that saw regular play, one that I brought out to events, and it's awesome to see kind of like not a ton, but just this smattering of new drawing games doing something interesting and different. I now have a handful of drawing games that I'll happily play anytime. And right now, Caution Signs is on the top of that list. If you enjoy drawing games at all, you need to rush out and pick up Caution Signs. Let's make this one sell out, force them to do another printing and maybe expansions. I'd love to see a themed version of this or just more cards.
Oh, yeah. No, I'm all for more cards. And can you imagine if it was like a fantasy themed expansion or a sci-fi themed expansion? That would be super fun.
Now you have panda bears, bears, and owl bears all in the same deck together.
Yes. And then he had the science expansion with the tardigrade. And you're like, oh, the loving tardigrade. How do you draw that? Now, here's the interesting one. And I don't know if we've gotten this across well enough, is if you don't like drawing games, you really should try this. And that's for two reasons. One is that whole thing we talked about multiple times. I think we drilled this in, that you don't have enough time to draw well. So drawing skill isn't the advantage it can be in many of the other games in this genre. The second, though, is that whole deduction thing. This is the new part. This adds a puzzle aspect to the game, and it can be just as fun to guess as it is to sketch. Honestly, I would say possibly more fun. But even just watching the person do the deduction and watching how they're like, oh, it's this and this, and then you're like, you're trying not to help, right? Because you don't want to grunt or make the wrong, oh, you know, you don't want to do that and spoil it. I absolutely adore the deduction part of Caution Signs.
I don't like drawing games in general. I really don't. I will willingly sit down and play, you know, illustrations and stuff because it is polite and it's what the rest of the group are doing. But I don't dig drawing games. And I don't like games that have a timer. I don't like that makes me feel anxious. I don't enjoy it. The short timer in this game, once you realize, you have to come to that realization that your goal in this game is to try and figure out very quickly when you look at that word, how you are going to relate that to the guesser. And it doesn't have to be a great image. It just has to relate that information to the guesser. And there's that puzzle-like aspect there. If once my brain made that click, now I like the game.
Yeah, when the first time I saw a sign, I tried to draw something and I failed miserably because there was just not enough time to draw something. You need to sketch an idea to you know, the bare minimum concept to get your ideas across to someone is all there is time for.
Caution, end of the review and self-promotion ahead.
That's it for our look at Caution Signs from Wacky Wizard Games, the new family game imprint of Wise Wizard Games. This game was way more fun than I expected, and as you know, I'm not usually into lighter party games. If you're a heavier gamer like me, what's another lighter game that won you over? Let us know.
Now, speaking of signs, why not be our billboard and sport some of our awesome merch, which you can get from tabletopbellhop.com/merch. The game is Shadow Ninjas. One player takes on the role of samurai dogs protecting the shogun's koi. The other players are ninja cats trying to steal them. A one-verse-many competitive board game from Outset Media, who we have to thank for letting us take a review copy home from Origins.
Now, we had the pleasure of learning Shadow Ninjas from the game's designer, Kedrick Winks. His game plays 2 to 5 players of almost any age, with games taking under half an hour. For the most part, sometimes if there's a lot of bluffing going on, like our game, it can go a little longer.
Yeah, I was amused when we played with him. He was like, oh, this is going a little longer than most games, but we did bluff quite a bit. Shadow Ninjas features some really nice production quality, including the clear maze-filled board and lots of thick plastic tokens for the cats, their shadows, and the dogs. These tokens, they just feel great in your hand and they slide nicely on the board.
Now, in Shadow Ninjas, one player takes on the role of 2 corgi samurai dogs. The other players control 4 ninja cats and their shadows, all represented by similar-looking tokens. While shadows are the same on both sides, the cats have a ninja side and a shadow side, so you can't tell them apart from the shadows when placed on the board.
So each ninja player is assigned a cat token, or more if you're playing with the lower player counts, you play multiple cats, and also gets a number of shadow tokens. While the dog player is not looking, they're going to place their mix of tokens onto the starting area of the board without letting anyone know which one is their ninja. That includes the other cat players. Then the dog player turns around and gets to place his 2 guards on any of the koi fish spots at the top of the board.
Each round in Shadow Ninjas starts with the guard player and then will go clockwise around the table. On a player's turn, they roll 2d6 and then move 2 different tokens, exactly the number shown on each die. And the guard is forced to move both of their guard dogs. The other players can move any 2 cat tokens. It doesn't even have to be their own. Or a player can choose to pass instead of moving, which will allow them to look at any 4 tokens on the board. It's great for when you forget where your cat is.
Now, all movement is orthogonal, and if a piece would move onto another piece, they instead do-si-do when and are swapped. If at any point there is a cat token in direct line of sight of a guard dog, the token is flipped.
Now, if a shadow is revealed, it stays on the board just to confuse and misdirect the players and mess them up later. If it's a ninja, though, that token's removed and the player who owns that ninja is removed from play. If all ninja players are eliminated, the guard player wins the game.
If a cat token ever reaches one of the koi ponds, it gets flipped over. And then you see if it's a shadow token, it gets returned to the start area. But if it's a ninja, the controller of that cat will win the game.
While that sounds simple, what you may not grasp until you actually sit down and play Shadow Ninjas is just how hard it is to keep track of everything. Mm-hmm. Also, while this sounds like a cooperative one versus many game, and while cats may end up working together in the short term, it is a competitive game where everyone is looking out for themselves.
Yeah, a big part of this game is deception, misdirection, as well as memory. You don't want to be too obvious with which token is your cat, or someone else is just going to run them right into a guard. But you also don't want to move a piece that you don't know what it is too close to the koi, just in case it's another player's ninja. And it's very, very likely you will mess up and forget either where your cat is, or where what's a shadow and what isn't, and what even is happening halfway through the game after a bunch of do-si-do-ing happens, especially when playing with certain players who just like to mess with everyone.
Yeah, well, bluffing is a huge part of this game. And while you do get to run those cats together and flip them in a little do-si-do to try and mix up which ones are which to confuse everyone else at the table, I did find that in the end I ended up confusing myself as well by doing a little too much swapping around.
Yeah, memory, well, apparently I don't have one, because the first time I played this game, I lost track of my cat in maybe the first four turns. Of course, I didn't know that I had lost track of my cat, so I was surprised as anyone when it was revealed.
Now, during the first few plays of Shadow Ninjas, you're probably going to find the guards have a big advantage, but I will say that does dwindle as players get more experience playing the ninjas and get better at both deceiving the guards and each other. Now, I will still say the guards are easiest to play. If you're looking for like the easy role for someone to take, that's probably the best role for them to play. The game does seem balanced, though, with experienced players. Now, one of the big advantages the ninjas have is the fact they get to go four times before the guards go. Like, all four of them get that. Technically, with three players, only three. But if you're playing two, there's still four. And this is the reason that players get more than one cat at the lower player counts, is for that balance. Because how often the guards go is huge for them. Like, once you start losing cats, the guard's job just gets so much easier and they get to move more often. This is why players will want to actually kind of cooperate early in the game and try to mislead the guards and kind of work together for a bit, only to betray each other later, like a proper ninja would.
Yeah, I taught this at our last public play event, and with a table of new players, playing as the guard dogs feels, it's just too easy, right? I felt guilty for winning, but it was still fun, though. So I find that it is fun from both sides, from the cat or the dog side.
Yeah, this game for me is as much, if not more, of a bluffing game than something like poker. But of course, in order to do that, you have to be able to keep the identity of at least your pieces in mind, as well mm-hmm. as your suspicions of the other players' locations to prevent them from winning, while misdirecting the dogs and working your way to win.
Now, an aspect of Shadow Ninjas that does turn off some gamers is the randomness. This is a roll and move game, right? You've got some classic board gaming mechanics here. If the guards roll a bunch of double sixes, the cats are going to have a bad time of it. It's probably going to be a quick game. Similarly, one player getting a bunch of high rolls can give them an advantage, though it does get offset by the ability of the other players to move the same pieces if it seems like someone's getting too far away.
Yeah, there is some randomness here from the dice, but I don't think it breaks the game. I think I remember Kedrick saying that they tested it with set player movement numbers, and yeah, it just wasn't the same. And I think I can see why you need that randomness. If you had a set number of movement points each turn, then you could plan ahead more. And that removes some of the having to adapt to the situation part of the game that that tiny bit of randomness throws in there.
Now, this game also features a mechanic that we generally do not recommend, and that's player elimination. Mm-hmm. Players will be eliminated and have to sit out while the game continues. Now, this isn't often a long game, so it's not onerous, but if you're playing with younger players in particular, this can be problematic. Kendrick recommends just moving them back to the start for younger players rather than eliminating, so they can continue participating even though they may not have the chance to win anymore.
Now, the other thing that was mentioned, and I did see this with other groups, is there is that kind of the one versus many feel. So even when you're eliminated, then you're still rooting for the cats. You at least want the cats to win. You're no longer, well, I guess you could be like, no, I want everyone else to fail. But every group I've seen playing the game, if you're eliminated, you're still invested in the cats winning and at least beating that guard dog player. Now, the thing I want to call out about Shadow Ninjas, this is kind of unique to me, but is a similarity to another cat-based bluffing game, which in Canada from Chieftain Games was called Cats or Cats Mansion in the States and the UK. I've talked about this on the podcast before. It's been mentioned on the blog. This is a silly game I had growing up in the 80s that I still break out now and then. We try to play it at least once a year. And it are five cats, each trying to get one of four presents. And similar to Shadow Ninjas, no one knows what cat the other players are or what present they're going for. And when you move, you can move any piece. It doesn't have to be yours. And when Kedrick first described Shadow Ninjas, I'm just sitting there smiling because I'm like, it's cats. This is awesome. It's like a better version of Cats. So if you remember Cats Mansion fondly, think of Shadow Ninjas as an advanced and much better version.
There are some similarities, but Shadow Ninjas is a better game and also readily available without a time machine.
Fair enough. Overall, I really dig this one versus many versus themselves bluffing game. The gameplay is lightning quick. It's easy to teach. It's been a huge hit at our local public play events. My kids love it. My mother-in-law had fun with it. Super accessible, and it's just kind of silly and fun. Even the randomness of the dice is just part of the chaos and fun factor here.
If you're into lighter games that play quick but still have a ton of player agency with tons of options each turn, or games with memory and bluffing elements, then you're probably going to love Shadow Ninjas. If you're looking for a competitive one versus many game, this is an interesting one with its semi-cooperative turning cutthroat nature.
Now, if you don't like randomness and prefer your abstract games with a more chess-like feel, this probably isn't the game for you. The same goes if you are dead set against player elimination. Though, I do have to say, the two-player game does give you more of that intellectual challenge than the player counts, so maybe give it a shot.
I honestly feel like this is one of those games where everyone should just give it a shot. You may like it.
Now, personally, I'm super happy Kedrick introduced us to his game. And I got to say props to everyone at the Outset Media booth at Origins for just being awesome and welcoming and showing us a good time. We basically spent most of our morning there. And special thanks to Outset Media Guy for getting Kedrick to sign our copies of his games, which was pretty awesome. I never even thought of getting my game signed by designers. That was a thing at Origins this time. And plus, he knew about Cat's Mansion. Outset Media Guy was a playtester. He tells me it's a terrible game, and I tell him it's still fun. I got to say, Shadow Ninjas is going to be a regular at Bellhop Public Play events for months, possibly even years to come. Like, this is just one that I think is just going to be on the table.
And with that, poof, this review is done. Was it really a review, or was it just a shadow of a review? You better go check on the koi just in case.
Now, while working on this review, I realized we really haven't played a lot of one versus many games. Not counting like the Game Master style, right? But like the other ones where there's one player has a totally different role from everyone else. And I think this might be an oversight that we might want to try to fix, something expand our little gaming knowledge here. So what I want to know from you is, what's a one versus many board game that we should take the time to check out? Let us know in the comments, on social media, or on our Discord.
Now, one thing I like many of is coffee. And it's time for a top up. You can help keep us motivated and caffeinated through ko-fi.com/tabletopbellhop. It's time to go shopping with Hornhelm Wasteland Market, the sixth map pack for the fantasy flip and draw Cartographers.
This expansion pack that works with both Cartographers, A Role Player's Tale, and Cartographer Heroes, was designed by Jordy Adam and John Brieger, is considered the most difficult expansion for Cartographers yet. It keeps the original game player count, age recommendation, etc., but may take a bit longer due to some added weight.
Physically, this expansion includes 150 double-sided map sheets with a new map on one side and a market featuring 9 items on the back. You also get a new card type, a small deck of 6 merchant cards, and instructions on how to use all of these new things.
Now, when playing with Hornhelm, you take two sheets of the included pad and you will use the map side of one with the market side of another. Once you play, you can flip these sheets and use them for another game. Rules as written, you cannot use the market with other cartographers' maps.
Now, while playing Cartographers with Hornhelm Wasteland Market, you play the first season the same as normal, just using the new map sheet. After spring scoring, the market enters play. You flip up a random market card. This will be showing a grid which shows three stalls that are open for that season. You compare this to your market sheet to find out what goods are available.
Immediately after the market card is flipped, but before you reveal the first terrain card, players have the option to purchase an item. Each item provides the players with a way to earn journal points, which are tracked on the market sheet. Each time a player fulfills a requirement for an item that they own, they get to tick off diamonds on the journal track. For example, the spiked boots give you 2 journal points every time you surround a mountain space, while the bedroll gives you 1 point whenever you draw a village next to an existing village on your map.
Now, at the start of each remaining season, a new card is drawn from the market deck, making different items available. At the end of the game, players get points based on how far they have progressed on the journal track, getting a whopping 55 points if they manage to fill it completely.
Which we still haven't seen, so I'm still challenging someone locally to hit that record. Now, the rest of the game plays identical to base Cartographers, either version. Now, of course, the big thing to talk about with this expansion is the market, right? Now you have a way to spend your gold, which is a significant change from Cartographers that adds a really difficult decision to the game. Because the new discovery track, as we just mentioned, can be worth a lot of points. But buying items means losing those gold, and those gold in this game are passive points that you score every round. If you get a bunch of gold early in the game, you just keep scoring it season after season. Now, the other thing is that it's kind of, there's a risk reward. You're taking a chance because the randomness of the deck will play a big part, because you could buy an item and never have the right terrain come up or the right type of card or a card that's big enough. And that makes things really interesting and does add a new decision space of, man, what is the right way to do this?
Yeah, it adds some decision spaces to the game, but I think the pre-planning aspect is less than I expected. Like, we laid this out in front of me. I looked at the market and I went, oh, well, I know I'm going to want to buy that right away as soon as I can. Well, then first off, it's randomized which items in the market are available to you. And then secondly, even if you buy it, your cards may never align with you having bought that to get the journal points and make it worthwhile. You have no idea. So it's coins are worth points and they stay and get scored each round. Do I spend my points to potentially get more points, or do I hold on to my cards? I'm curious to know, and we haven't actually tested this part out, if just ignoring the market and keeping all the coins could be a winning strategy.
Well, we did. One of the players we played with tried that strategy and it did not work out for them. They got the lowest score out of 4 of us playing.
Now, unfortunately, there is a lack of clarity in the rules regarding purchases and when you can purchase.
Yeah.
Now, while the BGG forums have offered the correct response, they are, as written in the rules, interpretable. And that means that one group may not play them the same as another, especially if they're not in the habit of popping into Board Game Geek and reading the errata a publisher has inserted into a random forum thread.
Yeah. Yeah, because so far with this one, you know, the Bellhop's Law is true. We did play Extreme on our first game, and on our second, we got something wrong. The first two things we did, though, was to first put a market card out first in the first season. And that one, just my mistake, right? In the rule book, it says you put one out summer, fall, and winter. It just didn't click in. Plus, the new map starts you with 1 gold. So to me, that was like, here's your chance to purchase something right at the start of the game. That just me misinterpreting the intention of the rules and misreading. So can't blame the publisher on that one. But the other one is the mid-game, we figured out that you cannot buy more than one thing, and you can buy them when you want. You have to do it at the beginning of the round before anything's revealed. Where when the way that's described in the rule book, I thought it was when you flip the card, you get a chance to buy, but then it has a description of how to buy things, and I thought you could do that later. So it's actually a restriction on when you can buy and not an opportunity to buy at the start of the round.
You can get a max of 1 item per season.
Yes. Or
3 items max for the whole game.
For the whole game.
And that restriction on what you can buy, I think, is a good thing, because if I can buy from the market at any point in each turn, that's one more thing that I'm going to stop and consider each turn. And honestly, it was slowing me down in our game where we were getting it wrong. Like, I was feeling a bit of AP when we played with those rules. My turns were dragging.
So this mistake or loose reading of overly vague rules is actually a major bonus, as it allows you to wait for the opportune moment to purchase your items, which would means that there's less of a chance to purchase one that might be of no use if you follow those rules incorrectly written.
Yeah, so even more so, I want to see someone score 55 points, because I think you got to be dang lucky. I don't know. Now, I say having a market and new resource as a way to generate points does up the difficulty and weight of cartographers. Like, the Deanna had more AP than before. Now, we were playing a game, the rules wrong for that game. But it was a little, like, I already found cartographers heavier than I thought it was going to be. Again, missed expectations. I just expect rolling rights and flipping rights. I should remove this from my head. But in my head, they tend to be lighter party games. Well, they're not, right? Like, this is the Cartographers is not a light party game. It's a pretty heavy game. And this makes it just that little bit heavier. I personally can't see just starting with this, right? If I bring this out to the public play event, I'm just going to bring the base game of Cartographers Heroes. I'm not going to include Hornhelm. Now, if I'm playing with people who I played with before, we go to the coffee shop and play, I'm probably going to toss it in.
Yeah, it's really not that heavy, but adding in that extra set of decision points when teaching this game can really bog it down and adds unnecessary complexity to what is otherwise a straightforward game.
You see, I kind of disagree. I felt like this just added more of the same to the game. Like, there's nothing earth-shattering here. There's nothing that alters the game in a significant, mind-blowing way. It's just a few tweaks and more of the same, which means, for anyone that enjoys the base game, you're going to like this as well. Though I may concede your point, Mo, that I would rather teach the base game to a new player than teach them this version.
Like I said, for experienced players, I think it's great. Now, one thing that is interesting, or I find a little odd, is the rule book says this works with Cartographers of Role Player's Tale, which is the original version of the game, and Cartographers Heroes, which is what I have. There's some wonkiness with one particular item, the one in the middle, which is the compass. Because when you play with heroes, the ruins on the sheet usually mean nothing. There are no ruin cards in Cartographer Heroes. So you can more easily avoid covering the ruin spots. There's nothing that forces you to draw on top of them as there is in the base game, which makes earning journal points for that particular piece way easier than the original. Now, I don't know if it's unbalanced, but it just feels off. Like maybe it should cost 2 coins if you're just playing heroes or something. Like, I think if I'm playing and that item's ever up, I'm just going to take it.
Yeah, we tried house ruling it so that the compass item just didn't exist in our games, but then that also felt off. So I'm really not sure what the answer is there.
Now, I also found it was odd that there is nothing at all in the book about using it with existing maps or using the new map without using the market. Now, I did note the new map is different. You seem to get more gold, right? You start with 1 gold for one, which is significant. Plus, there's a particular mountain that has a chasm next to it, so it only takes 3 squares to surround it, so that makes getting gold earlier. But I do wonder, like, why couldn't you just mix things up? And if you do try this, let us know how it goes.
Yeah, apparently the provided map is the only one that was playtested with the new rules, but no one's stopping you from using it with other maps. They just aren't promising anything either.
Finally, we get to my biggest complaint about this particular expansion, and that is the brightness and contrast of the new sheets. For whatever reason, the map sheets, both sides, are printed significantly darker than the other map pads I have. They're dark enough that parts of them are hard to read. This is especially true for the terrain icons for each item and the points awarded on the discovery track. In slightly dull light, they're almost impossible to read, and even in bright light, I can't make out some of the symbols on the terrain. Now, thankfully, they're also color-coded, so I can tell which is which, but without that, or perhaps if I had color blindness, it might have been totally unreadable.
Yeah, it's bad. The stars with the journal points, I found those almost impossible to read. Like, for example, you just said that the one at the end of it is 55. I had no idea that that was the max amount you could score. I think someone probably felt like making the paper look dark and aged was a cool aesthetic, but I will take clarity over theming any day.
Yeah, even with a phone flashlight held up against them right in front of my eyes, it was barely readable. It's just a really odd choice.
Now, overall, I dig the Hornhelm Wasteland market for cartographers. I'm pretty much universally attracted to any expansion that gives me more options in a game. especially if it's a thinky game like Cartographers. Though I do, again, worry this adds a bit much for casual fans. If you play Cartographers as a beer and pretzels thing, you probably don't need the added complexity.
Now, if you are a longtime Cartographers fan who is always looking for new things to explore and who welcomes new options, I recommend picking up the Hornhelm expansion. The market adds an entirely new level to a game you already enjoy.
I strongly feel that if you enjoy the base game of Cartographers, you're going to like this expansion. It's more of the same, which is a small taste of something new to keep the game fresh.
Now, I've found it made a little bit more impact than that, but if you are more of a casual Cartographer fan who's still new to the game, you might want to hold off on this one just a bit. If you're still discovering new things and you're still getting excited by cards that are coming up, just put this one in the back burner for a little bit or check out the 5 other expansions for Cartographers.
That's it for a quick look at the Hornhelm Wasteland Market Expansion for Cartographers, the 6th and so far final map pack expansion for this fantasy flip and draw game. Are you a Cartographers fan? Are you someone who's tried all the expansions? What's your favorite so far? Which map pack or packs do you prefer to play with?
Let us know by commenting wherever you found this review or tag us on social media where we can be found everywhere as Tabletop Bellhop, one word. Well, that was the double bell.
That means our shift's coming to an end and we're going to have to lock the lobby doors.
Before we start locking things down, let's take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons.
Roger Malosh, thank you.
David Miller Jr., thank you.
Ron F., thank you, Ron.
Kat and Tori, who we haven't seen in so long, thank you.
Jeff and Sheila Seuss, who I'm super happy to see at a lot of our public play events recently. That's awesome to see you guys.
Brian Kurtz, always thank you. Now, while the show is done, you can find us at tabletopbellhop.com or all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Get even more bellhop by joining our Patreon. Get access to our pre-production show notes, bonus audio, outtakes, first thoughts, reviews, and more.
Also, be sure to subscribe on Spotify or Apple Podcasts, YouTube, Twitch, or wherever you choose to listen or watch. You already done that? Then how about leaving us a review or helping other people to discover us? That's all for tonight.
For Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And game on.